OLSAT-8 assessment, so that's what we're here for. There are handouts in the back. We have the blue handout is in English, and then the orange one in Spanish. So it is a handout that goes along with this PowerPoint. So welcome. My name is Michelle Papazian, and I am down here. I am a specialist with the Gifted Talented Programs Office, and I will be presenting to you today about the OLSAT-8. This is our office. We call it our tiny but mighty office. We don't have too many people in the office, but we service over 65,000 students. Some of my colleagues are here. They're in the back, and I'd like to introduce them to you. We have Dr. Lucy Hunt, and she is a coordinator for Local District Central for this local district. We have Susanna Ferfari. She is our coordinator for Local District Northeast. And we have one of our psychologists who assesses students for gifted, talented, and that's Carol Groh, and she's back there. You may have met her on your way in. So we are gifted, talented programs, and we're part of Advanced Learning Options. Our information is here. You can contact us via email or the phone number that you see. Today we're going to talk to you about the OLSAT, what the OLSAT is all about. Just give me one second. To you about what the OLSAT entails and all the information you need to know to decide whether or not you'd like to have your child assessed. I want you to know that your PowerPoint, the handout that you have, may not exactly match what I have. I have added some additional information for you, so if you notice some things are different, we do know about it. We just wanted to add some more information. We are going to update our website with the latest version of this PowerPoint. Okay, so what is the OLSAT-8? So the OLSAT-8 is an assessment that is nationally standardized and norm referenced. It is an assessment that is administered in the classroom by a teacher, and it could be group administered, so whole group, the whole class, or it could be to an individual student. And it stands for the Otis-Lennon School Ability Test. So we are going to administer this test, LAUSD is going to administer this test to every single second grader in the district. So every single second grader has an opportunity to take this test. It also, if you're wondering, includes students who may have a learning disability, who may be in a special education classroom. It also includes students who are new to the country and maybe don't speak English proficiently yet. So all students can be assessed. There are a few instances in which we have exemptions for students, and I'll go over that in a moment. So why exactly do we administer this assessment to every single second grader? This assessment is a universal screening tool that our office uses to identify students for gifted, talented programs. So we want to make sure that we give every student an opportunity to be screened at some point in their education. And so we don't want to leave any student behind. We don't want to overlook any student. We want to make sure that we have given students that opportunity. In addition, we want to make sure that we don't have any disproportionality in our identifying students, because in 2009, the Office for Civil Rights did find disproportionality in the number of students that are identified as gifted, talented,
be if your student is on an alternative curriculum. If they are on one of those, then they do not have to take this test. If you are not sure, you can check with your child's teacher. But really, if your child was on one, you probably would know. You would have consented to it and signed paperwork on it. The second instance in which your child does not have to take this test, of course, is if you say no. If you don't want your child to take it, and you have your child opt out of this assessment. The third instance would be if your child took this test in second grade, maybe in another district, or was in second grade before, maybe is repeating second grade, or your child was exposed to this assessment, so they've already seen this test, then they cannot take it. And the last instance would be if your child is already gifted intellectually, and you're okay with them not taking this test because they are already identified gifted, then they don't have to. That's optional, it's up to you. We're not saying that they're completely exempt and they don't have to take it. It is your decision, your choice. So again, we're going to use this test to identify students who are gifted, talented. We offer 7 different categories of gifted, talented in our district. And we are the only district, as a matter of fact, that has 7 different categories. So we're not going to go into too much detail because we don't have that much time. But the 7 different categories are listed up here. We have intellectual, we have specific academic ability, we have high achievement, we have creative ability, we have visual arts, performing arts, we also have leadership. So our schools routinely, consistently screen students for all 7 of these categories. So, do you know which one of these 7 categories, the OLSAT-8, would identify your students in? If you were to take a guess, which one would it be? And don't cheat and look at the answers in your PowerPoint. Anyone? Is it 8? How many say 8? B? C? A? D? E? F? There's no F. Is there an F? G? Which, you're right, it is high achievement, letter C. How did you guys know that? How did you know it was high achievement? Anyone? It was what? Because it's gifted? Well, these are all gifted. All of these categories will qualify your child as gifted and talented. But it is C, high achievement. So if you've heard of highly gifted magnets, which there are only 4 in the district, and you really want your child to go to a highly gifted magnet, this test does not measure that. It does not find students eligible for highly gifted magnets. If you would like your child to be tested for that, that would be in the intellectual category. And so we would provide that student with an intellectual assessment, and that's done only by one of our psychologists. Okay, so this is strictly an achievement test. So let's take a look at the OLSAT breakdown. Parents, there are 3 parts to the OLSAT. 60 questions in all. Approximately 82 minutes for this test. That includes breaks, and it includes sample questions, which are not timed. Parts 1 and 2 are taken together in one day, and part 3 is taken on another day. Each part and every question is timed. So the teacher is keeping track of the time and notifying the students. The answers are marked directly in the booklet. So they don't have 2 different booklets, it's only 1 booklet, and they get to bubble in. And I'll show you some samples in just a moment. And here's something that's really, really important. Other than that the test is timed, the questions can only be read once. They cannot be repeated. So the test was designed in such a way that would make it easy for students. There are features on this assessment that'll help students out. For example, there are sample questions before every section. In the sample questions, the teacher can stop, go over the answers, and make sure that everyone knows what they're doing. And the teacher can ask, did you understand? And the student can say yes or no, or I'm confused about this, and the teacher can help out with any questions that they have. Secondly, the assessment uses pictures throughout the entire book. There's no reading involved at all, there's no writing. It's all using pictures, so it's a visual assessment. There are subtests, and the two subtests are verbal and nonverbal, and they're clearly marked for the students. They can see the numbers are there. And again, the questions are directed by the teacher, so they don't have to read the question. So that's actually really good, because if you don't, you're not reading well, you may be struggling, you don't speak English really well, this test is designed to ensure that all students have an opportunity to show that their giftedness and talents. Okay, so something really important about this test, there are no accommodations or modifications allowed. So if your child has an IEP or a 504, and in their IEP or 504 it says that they have to have extended time on tests, we cannot do that for this assessment. So there's no extended time. And in addition to that, the questions and directions can only be read once, so it cannot be repeated. And the content, the test itself, can, or the questions on there, cannot be modified, so the teacher can't change that. The only thing that we do allow is for students to take the assessment either in smaller groups or individually, especially if the teacher has to administer it in another language, then they have to take it in a small group or perhaps alone. That does not invalidate the test. But doing any one of these three will invalidate the test for your child. Okay, so as we mentioned earlier, we're gonna have English language learners taking this assessment, and that is totally okay. But that is going to be a school site decision. So talk to the teacher and the administrator, the principal. This will be their decision whether or not it will be administered in the student's primary language. But no matter what language it's administered in, again, I repeat, the questions can only be read once. So on this assessment, we have a list of things that are measured. And what you see up here are what we call abilities that show school success. For example, detecting likeness and difference, kind of like comparing and contrasting. We also have recalling words and numbers, defining words, following directions, classifying, establishing sequence, solving arithmetic problems, and completing analogies. Now, I told you a little while ago it's not going to have any words, and I also told you it's not going to have math problems. You might be looking up there and wondering, but well, I see defining words and I see solving arithmetic problems. I'll show you how those two are embedded into the test without necessarily being directly recalling of the words. So I'll give you some examples. So the test is broken up into two sections. So on day one, your students will take the nonverbal section. The nonverbal section will basically be the teacher giving direction, letting them know what they have to do, and then they work alone from there. The teacher will pace and make sure that the students are all where they should be, not falling behind. But other than that, the teacher does not stop and ask a question for each one of the problems. On day two, the verbal section, it will be that way. The teacher will be reading every question out loud, waiting for the students to mark their answer, and then go on to the next question. On day one, it will be students should take approximately 1 minute, 44 seconds on each question. And on day two, students should take approximately 2 minutes on each question. Again, because is time. So make sure you talk to your students, your children about that so that they know to pace themselves as well. It's very important that they know that the teacher cannot repeat the question more than once. So you know how young children can be. Oftentimes they're distracted, they're looking around the room, and then they say, what did you say? And the teacher cannot repeat it. So it's very important you address this with them so that they know that for this particular day, this particular test, they really have to concentrate and listen to the teacher. So here's an example of a non-verbal problem, one that your children will be solving on their own. So this is called picture classification. And basically, it's looking for things that are alike and things that are different, things that are the same and things that are different. So they're going to be comparing the five pictures that they see, and they have to find the one that is different. So for example, the teacher will tell them on the next 10 problems, you will find pictures that are different. So look for the one that is not the same. So how about you guys take a look and you tell me, which one of these pictures does not belong? Which one is different from the rest? Is it the first one? Second one? Third one? Fourth? Or the fifth? Yes, good job, you're all gifted. Yes, it is the fourth one. Why is it the fourth one? What do all four have in common that this picture does not? Anybody? All the pictures, you have two students, and they're both on objects with what? Wheels, right? So it's two students, objects, two wheels. Do you see the arithmetic I'm doing? It's two, two. So I'm looking for the number two there. That's the kind of arithmetic that they will find over there. So it won't be any multiplication, division, or addition, computation like that. So here's another non-verbal pictorial reasoning problem, and this is called a picture analogy. You remember those, right? Those analogies you have to do. You're looking at the first two pictures, and then downward, so you have to find what they have in common, what's the pattern, what's the relationship, and then down below, find the same relationship, find the same pattern here. Select one of those pictures. So you see two chairs with no kids, then you see two chairs with two kids. So what picture could go here? Anyone first? This one? Second? It is the second one, correct. Because what's the relationship? What's the analogy? Right? You have two objects here with no kids, and then you have two objects with. So that is the relationship. Now, you might think that that's really easy, but these are samples, so keep that in mind. The actual test question will not be that easy. So here we have figural reasoning. So it's doing the same thing as a problem before, except it's not with pictures, but it's with geometric figures. So the students would look at this, and then look to the picture right next to it and find the relationship. So what happened here? This was vertical, and then what happened?
Horizontal.
It became horizontal, right. And also what changed?
The color.
The colors, right. Same thing here. So which one would go into this box? Which one belongs there? It is the fourth one. That's correct. Okay, and I think this is our last one. This is figural reasoning pattern matrix. So they're doing the same thing, except they're now looking specifically for a pattern, excuse me. So they're looking at the top row, looking at the second row, and then looking at the third row to fill in. Which one would go into the last row, the last picture, second. second, third, or fourth?
Third.
It is the third one. That is correct. Okay. So those are all samples, and again, the teacher is going to go over every sample question and make sure that they understand what to do when she leaves them alone. So you're wondering, will my child get to practice for this test? The answer is yes. So approximately 1 week before the test, the teacher is going to give your child a practice test composed of 12 problems. They will then go over those problems together so that everyone understands why they are the answers that they are, correct them, and they're going to send the test home to you with a cover letter. So if you don't see that test coming home in the near future, check with your child's teacher. Find out when that is going to be provided to your child. The test is an official product from Pearson, the people who make the OLSAT. So taking this practice test will not invalidate your child's score on the actual OLSAT. In addition to that, I would say there's a cover letter that's going to come with that, explaining basically what we covered here, but some additional information for you. So the test dates. The school gets to pick between two test dates. So it's either March 6th and 7th, because remember the test is broken up into 2 days, or they can pick March 20th and 21st. We also offer two makeup days. So the 13th and 25th of March will be the makeup days if your children miss it. The school again is going to decide on which two dates and they're going to inform you. They are going to inform you with a letter that states the date the test is going to be taken. On there you'll see the meeting dates that are offered for parent meetings like the one you're at today. And then on the bottom, you're going to see a section that says, I do not want my child to take this test. Okay. Do not fill out that section if you want your child to take the test. That is an opt-out form. So after listening to all this information, you can decide if you do want your child to take it. And if you do, then do not fill that out. So if you decide you do want your child to take it, some things that you can do that will help, some things your child can do that will help them on the day of testing. These are the usual things kids do, right, before they take a big test. You want them to rest, you want them to eat, so they need to go to bed on time, they need to eat a healthy breakfast the morning of, listen, right? That's very important for this test because it's time. The questions are not repeated. And tell them to try their best, okay? We don't want to put too much pressure on them. Don't let them worry too much about the assessment. So tell them to have fun and try their best with it. Some things you can do as a parent that will make the test a little more smoother, more successful for your child is talk about the test with your child. Discuss what the test is for. We don't want kids to feel bad if they do not pass the assessment and go into the GATE program. So discuss that this is a test that's used as a tool. It's a diagnostic tool. And so it's not to say that, you know, you're smart, you're not smart, everyone is. It's just a diagnostic tool that's used to place a student into a program that best suits your child. So again, support your child by doing all the things we talked about before. And lastly, tell them to relax. You know how the mind is when you're stressed out. So if you're worried, you're not going to do well because you're thinking about all the other things that are going on. So just let them know, it's no stress, and relax. So on May 2nd, the school is going to get a report. It's the student report, the scores are going to come in. You're not going to get it right away on May 2nd. The school will need some time, of course, to, you know, take it apart and do whatever they need to do with it. But approximately, around that time, you should be getting the results. Most likely it'll be during your parent conferences, the very last round of parent conferences. And you may want to check with them to see if it will be mailed or if it will be handed to you directly at the conference. Each school will do this differently, so again, check with them. When you get the report, what do you want to look for? Okay, you want to look for three things. You want to look for the word total, verbal, and nonverbal. Those are the three sections. If your child gets 95% or above in the total, the verbal, or the nonverbal, then this will qualify them. That means that they will be eligible to participate in the GATE program. Remember high achievement? They're going to be eligible in that category, high achievement. There's also one more way they could possibly qualify, and that is if they get a 90 to 94% in the total only, and they have a meal code of 1, 2, or 5. And what that basically means is they either eat lunch for free, or they have a reduced lunch for when they pay for breakfast or lunch. Okay, so that is for students who are considered low income or economically disadvantaged. This is what the report will look like. The entire report is not there. This is just the top portion. So your child's name is going to be up here. You want to look at this chart right here, this table. So here you can see total, verbal, and nonverbal. So if we look all the way across, you want to find a column that says HPRS, because the way your child is scored is by comparing to other children of the same age. When the test was normed, when it was standardized, they used age as the factor to determine what qualifies. So we're not comparing second grade to second grade or third grade to third grade. It's going to be age of your child to other children who are the same age, and even right down to the week, as a matter of fact. So this student, if we take a look, got a total score of 94. That dash hyphen 8, don't worry about that, that doesn't really matter. So it's 94. Verbal, this is our day 2, student scored 92. And in the nonverbal, which was day 1, the student scored, what do we see here? 89. Okay. Would this student pass? Unless the total is 94. So technically, we don't see any 95, so we would say no, unless they have free and reduced lunch, because 95.